Welcome to Now Church. We are about to begin. Please take this opportunity to pull out your smartphone so you can like, share, and check in on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag NowChurch. Thank you, and enjoy today's service.
Let your praise be loud. Here in your house. a strong tower. Say it again. Say, the name of the Lord is a strong tower. We call you by your names, oh God. Yeah. He breaks every idol. He reigns without rival.
Shalom be your
Jehovah Nissi. So we bless your name, Jesus. So we honor you today, Jesus.
How many of you appreciate being able to come in and just be right in the presence of God? Anybody appreciate that this morning? It's awesome. I never take it for granted. I really, really don't. I was reading a devotional yesterday, and they were talking about how it's so interesting that the greatest part of our faith and our belief is the fact that Jesus is no longer in the grave, that he's risen. Come on. Come on, he's risen. And they were saying how it's interesting that a lot of times we don't talk about it a lot. We don't discuss it a whole lot in services or in churches. And I'm just grateful that one of the foundational beliefs and truths is that our God is no longer in the grave, but he is alive. He is risen indeed. Come on. The grave is empty. There's nothing there. He's alive. He's right here. He's in the room. He's somebody that we can serve in these moments. So God, we bless you in this place. And I ask you to do it a lot, but could you lift up your hands all over the building and just say this with me? Jesus, I am mindful that you are no longer in the grave, but you are alive in me, in this moment, and I worship you. Come on, let's worship him today. Let's worship him.
That's good news, church. Because if you looked in the grave today, you wouldn't find him there. Oh, yeah, 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 yeah. No enemy can hold you down, because there's nobody in the grave now. One head gets to wear that crown, because there's nobody in the grave. Sing it.
Jesus, Jesus,
sing Jesus,
Jesus.
Would you close your eyes in this room this morning? Could you call on your Savior in your own way, with your own song, in your own voice? Call His name, Jesus, Jesus.
Jesus, how I love the name of Jesus.
I love the name of Jesus. No longer in the grave.
We've been saying a lot about this and preparing for our Easter celebration, what we're going to be doing, Easter helicopter candy drop. And you know, it can't be communicated enough, because as we've talked about this the last couple of weeks, even I think Pastor Gail had mentioned this on our prayer night. She'd asked how many people had participated in this before. And we have a large amount of people here in our room that have not experienced that with us. And we say things like, this is our Super Bowl. Well, it is, and it should be a Super Bowl for so many churches, because there's so many people that still come, maybe on special occasions. And I heard someone talking about this recently that just really drove the point home. But there are so many times where Jesus, he was preaching a message. Jesus, the Jesus, preaching a message. And he was saying, if you have ears to hear, then let you hear. If you have ears to hear, that means that it was a condition of the person receiving to get the message from Jesus preaching. Let me just tell you that, because Jesus knew how to preach, because he's the Word. And he's saying, it's your condition to be able to receive what I'm trying to convey, these words of life. Now, here's the thought. With everything that's going on in the world, the enemy knows that if he can create so much distortion, so much static, so much activity, so many things trying to grab people's attention so that it can just cloud out that one moment of hearing what he's saying, what Jesus is saying. If you can have ears to hear to turn out everything else. So why do we do what we do? Well, we rent a big helicopter and we load it full of candy and we get a bunch of kids crazed on sugar and we get them out here and they get families excited. Yes. Why do we do this? This is not gimmickry. This is to get attention so that we can preach the message of Jesus. And in that moment, they can hear what they need to hear. We will do anything God tells us to do. We'll stand on our head if it meant getting attention to hear the name of Jesus. That's why we're so passionate about it. That's why we say this is our Super Bowl. That's why we encourage every single one of you to be prayerful for this moment, to be just as impassioned, to know it's not just about all the candy. We get, you know, understand that. It's about the message. It's about Jesus. All right? So right now, I wanted to pray over that day because we have so much. And I just, we're going to pray. We're going to lead you in prayer now. But I just challenge you, be prayerful about this every day. Let's all hit this every day. And let's believe God, because we're coming into an incredible time. Father, we thank you, Lord, for the moment. And we thank you, Lord, for strategic, Lord, for strategic ways of getting people's attention. And Lord, right now, we just pray against every distraction that people would have in their life. All that busyness that keeps them from hearing the message of Jesus. That keeps them from focusing on the answer, the way, the truth, the life. Lord, we just believe you right now that you would anoint our preparation for this time. Father, we pray for the right pilot. We pray for great weather that day. Lord, we pray for invitations that are about to go out, that people respond and they come. Father, we pray for so many children that will be stirred and want to be a part of this presentation. Lord, for so many that have no idea what they're in store for, they're coming for the entertainment, they think. But Lord, we pray that you would capture their heart in this moment, capture their attention, and Lord, let them have ears to hear to receive what you're saying to them. Let them receive the words of life. And Lord, we thank you for salvation of souls. Those that are lost, draw them. Those that are wandering, draw them. Those that have no home spiritually, Lord, they're just wandering. Lord, trying to find purpose and meaning in life, draw them, Lord. Draw them across our path. Draw us across their path, that we would invite them and bring them for this time, Lord. And Lord, we just pray for great success that day. Let the enemy just be completely, completely surprised. Blinded the enemy, completely surprised in this moment, and turn this for good in so many lives. In Jesus' name, amen. Come on, let's celebrate God. This is why. This is why. Maybe I'm just more excited, but I tell you, I'm very excited about what's going to happen in that moment, right? It's just going to be incredible. Our team is preparing, so many people preparing. I'm going to share with you about some other stuff that just happened in a second, but I want you to turn around, welcome everybody around you to Now Church, and we're going to continue in just a minute. All right. So I just want to share with you a few things that happened even yesterday, we've been talking about so many things that we're doing and preparing, and we had a whole team gather together yesterday, and as we announced to you for the past couple of weeks, we're preparing for a spring spruce up. You know, we had several people sign up. We had a lot of people even just show up, and we had a whole army helping out. And so we got a few pictures here. And right now, you know, this is awesome. I gotta apologize because I could not get the pictures of everybody here to show you how many people were working on the property yesterday. But they took their time to come out. We even Friday, we had two people out here with their tractors that gave their time just to help and just work around the property and get everything set up. So we had people cleaning up, picking up. We had people doing a little bit of weeding and preparing and just everything, moving that area. If you just seen as you walked in, you saw that there were signs outside on the outfield showing you different areas where the kids are going to go. That's for Easter. That's not for now. You saw the registration big canopy out there. That's for Easter. It's not for now. It's coming, so we're just preparing you for that time. But we just want to encourage all of you. Maybe you didn't get a chance to come out yesterday. Maybe you're working, whatever. There's going to be other opportunities for you to join in, and I'll mention that at the end of service. But right now, I just want to give it up for everybody that worked so hard yesterday. You are a fantastic team. We love you. Thank you for your time. Man, there's so much that happens at Now Church, and we come in and we enjoy the moment and the services, but so much was put into it by those that are not seen. So we just want to love on all those unsung heroes. They're amazing, all right? So listen, we want to welcome you to Now Church. We're glad you're here. If it's your first time, make sure you go by our guest experience counter that's in the Legacy Building. We have some gifts for you just to welcome you to Now Church. And as always, we throw out a challenge every single service. Check out Now Church 3 weeks in a row and see what God does. We believe that God has you here right on time with a purpose. We want you to have ears to hear what God's doing today, right now in your life, all right? So right now, if you will, with me, welcome Pastor Richard as he's back from the nations, ready to bring a good word.
So just stick with me for a second. There's something happening in the room, and I just want to be obedient to the Holy Spirit. Just, if you can pray in the Spirit, just pray quietly in the Spirit for a moment. I just sense there's just a wave of healing and deliverance right now. Maybe you came in so bound today. Maybe you came in really heavy because it's been a tough moment or a tough season. I don't know what you're going through, but we want to just stop whatever we're doing and just flow with God right now. I'll say this, if you're in pain, if you're in physical pain in your body, would you just stand up right now? Just stand up right where you are. If you're in physical pain, having physical pain, man, I'd hoped it would be only one or two people. Okay, if you're part of this house, you've been through liftoff, and you are a faith-filled, spirit-filled believer, would you stand up now and get to somebody that's standing and put your hand on their shoulder? Find out where the pain is. You know, find out where their pain is right now. Find out where the pain is. Now, before we pray, I want to say something. One of our key drummers, Ricky, was walking out of a bathroom door in a restaurant the other day, and somebody flung open the door, and it ruptured his tendons in his pinky finger. And he is supposed to be playing the drums for Easter, and this week he's got to go to a physical therapist. So I need somebody to go back. He's directing today. Yes. So I need somebody to go back there. Let's see. There we go. Norm, thank you. Would you go back there to the control room and pray for Ricky right now? I really believe for healing for Ricky right now. Now, Father, in Jesus' name, we just pray for every person who's been in physical pain today. And we know some of these are natural pains of different things that have happened. But we also know some things have a demonic root. And right now, we declare the blood of Jesus Christ, the blood of the everlasting covenant over this place and over every person, over our community, our city, our county, our region, from Alachua County down to Lake County and Sumter County, Marion County, and everything around us. We declare the blood of Jesus in this room right now. It is the blood of the everlasting covenant that sets us free. And we say no demonic power has any right to afflict the believers, the people trusting Jesus in this house. We say, you spirit of affliction, we bind you up right now. We break your powers. We submit this to God. We resist that spiritual darkness. And your word says, Father, it must flee. Lord, we just pray according to your word that says, when we lay our hands upon the sick, they shall recover in the name of Jesus. And we release the power of the Holy Spirit right now into every situation and circumstance. We say, cancer, you have no power. Back problems, we speak to those vertebrae, we speak to the discs and the bones and the joints in the back right now. And we say, be loosened up in Jesus' name. Lord, we just release your healing wave. And we say, pain, you have no power to afflict the people of God. For it is written, no weapon formed against us shall prosper. And every tongue rising against us in judgment, we condemn. We break the words of darkness right now. We break the oppression of the wicked. And we release the healing power of our God. And Lord, we thank you that in you we find wholeness. In you we find peace. And we release your power right now into every situation and circumstance. And we speak life. This month is about resurrection. We say, live, dry bones. Live. Live, nerve endings that need to be rectified and justified. We speak in the name of Jesus, a divine wedge between all the blood vessels and the nerves. Anything inflamed, we say, you have no power to be swollen. In Jesus' name, we speak blessing and strength over every person today. And Father God, we promise you the praise and all the honor and all the glory. Only you can heal. You made us. You can repair us. And we trust you for it. In Jesus' name. In Jesus' name. Now everybody stand up on your feet and let's give Jesus a standing ovation. The mighty healer today. Praise him in advance like you know you got it. Because he's alive. Now y'all that came in pain, start to move around. Whatever was bothering you, start to move around to do something you couldn't do without pain before and trust God and then turn and greet some other people again. Okay, let's do it again. Greet some people around you and let them know Jesus is Lord. Amen. Oh, praise God. Well, it's good to be home. Thank you, Pastor Lindsay, for sticking with me. Listen, sometimes you just got to just ride the wind, you know what I mean? Sometimes it's not our power, it's his power. But sometimes you just got to flow with him. And, you know, some people get so bugged by time change. Do you hate the time change? You know, I know tonight when it's still light out at 7:30, you're going to love it. But I'm saying the first night. Okay, but I woke up with this morning, so I've been through 7 time changes in the last 2 weeks. When 2 weeks ago today we were in London, that was a 5-hour time difference. Then we went on to Amsterdam, that was a 6-hour time difference. Then we went to Romania, that's where it was last weekend, and that's a 7-hour time difference. Then we had to fly back and stop overnight in Amsterdam, that was coming back an hour. I mean, I don't even know what ocean I'm over right now. So anyway, I'm just glad you're here, but understand, put it in perspective. If you don't like the time change, you know, you just got to keep going. You know, the news media, I saw last night again, well, it's very dangerous to your health. Well, tell people that travel all the time. Come on, it's called adjustment, right? Anyway, open your Bibles, if you will, to John chapter 10. We're beginning a brand new thought for this month called the God of More Than Enough. God of More Than Enough. And it's really key that you kind of get this today because it's so important for your daily life that you understand who God is, what his nature is, what his character is, why his word is his bond. Why, if he said it, you can stand on it. You can trust him in it. I'm reading the first couple of passages from the Amplified Bible today. First is John chapter 10, verse 10. Most people know it by heart. But it says, the thief comes only in order to steal and to kill and to destroy. But Jesus said, I came that they, the people of God, may have and enjoy life. Well, that's a good statement. The chair two people don't know that one, by the way. If you were here in January, Jesus said, I came that my people may have life and enjoy life. That's a good place to smile, at least, okay? And have it in abundance to the full till it overflows. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. The shepherd risks and lays down his own life for the sheep. When Jesus says, I am, he's pointing to something, and the Bible always interprets the Bible. That's where people get all confused. So when Jesus says, he's talking about overflow, he's talking about abundance and enjoying life, and he points, he pivots and says, because, in effect, I am the good shepherd. I'm the good shepherd. And he actually points to the 23rd Psalm, which many of you, maybe if you grew up in church, maybe that was the first psalm you ever memorized. Well, let me read you from the Amplified just a couple of verses. So this is what Jesus is referencing when he's talking about abundant life and he's talking about being the good shepherd. Psalm 23, verse 1, David says, the Lord is my shepherd to feed, guide, and shield me. I shall not lack. We know that in the New King James says, I shall not want. I shall not want for anything, right? Verse 5, you prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil. My brimming cup runs over. It overflows. Surely or only goodness, pardon me, mercy and unfailing love shall follow me all the days of my life. And through the length of my days, the house of the Lord and his presence shall be my dwelling place. When we're in the house of God, the good shepherd is manifesting his presence. And in his presence, you will not lack. You will not lack any good thing. Finally, I want to weave in Psalm 78. Psalm 78 is when the children of Israel, we see this pattern that develops on their wilderness journey. And every time they go through something, they turn back to God. God, we're sorry. Oh, it's just, this is terrible. We've sinned. We've messed up. And they turn back. They repent. And guess what? Blessing comes. And within a season or a time, as the blessing comes, the eyes of the people go on the blessing instead of the blesser. And they forget God. And they lose his presence and power until they lather, rinse, repeat. Okay? Psalm 78 is that part. Verse 40. How often, the psalmist writes, they provoked God in the wilderness and grieved him in the desert. Yes, again and again, they tempted God and, look, limited the Holy One of Israel. They limited a limitless God. They did not remember his power the day when he redeemed them from the enemy. The Bible says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. I'm redeemed. I've been redeemed. I am set free. They didn't remember his power because they stopped talking about their redemption. The people that saw the Red Sea parted forgot what they saw. See, a lot of times we in the Western world will say, well, if I saw a miracle, I would be forever changed and I would never forget about it. I submit to you, you've already seen miracles. And you've already forgotten more than you saw. You've already forgotten. You've already forgotten it. Why? Because we're a people that, to us, our gratitude is only as good as the last thing we got. Let's pray one more time. God, open the eyes of our heart today and let your word dwell in us richly. We thank you that your word, your Bible, is inerrant, inspired, and infallible. And we trust in you with all of our hearts today. And we are redeemed. We are the redeemed of the Lord. And we proclaim it. We say so. And we praise you for it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. The God of more than enough. Getting back from Europe was really awesome. except for the stack of bills that were there when I got home after 2 weeks. When I went to pay the bills, then I got home Tuesday night. Wednesday, I'm doing bills. And I got the news that our mortgage payment went up by almost $250 a month. And they never told me. They never sent me anything. They just took it out of the account last month without telling me there was an adjustment. Both the taxes and the homeowner's insurance have exploded over the last couple of years for not just us, but for all of us, not to mention food costs, electricity, other utilities. And as I read the bank statement, I got upset. Stress was knocking at the door of my heart. Anxiety. Until we'd already planned the theme out a couple weeks ago. And I remembered that our God is the God of more than enough. Now, I'm not telling these things to him because I'm crying poor mouth. I will never use the pulpit to cry poor mouth and tell you my troubles. We are blessed upon blessed. But I will tell you, I think we can all relate. And I think the problem is when someone takes a big jump like that, you know, invariably, those kind of bills rise a little bit every year. But a big jump like $250 a month is, you know, that's it can send you into shockwaves. But the thought that our God is the God of more than enough brought peace to my anxious soul. And immediately this calm and this peace settled down over me. And then I wasn't angry. I was just like, okay, God, this is just more for you to provide and more that you're going to do. This month, as we prepare for Resurrection Sunday, we're going to look at one of the most important attributes of the nature of God. And that is the fact that he is sufficient, adequate, ample, and abundant. Let me say it again. He is sufficient, adequate, ample, and abundant. Maybe Mick Jagger couldn't get no satisfaction, but the followers of Jesus can. Right? There's a reminder. The world system works through shortage. That's how the world works. Everything works around shortage. Supply goes down, demand goes up, prices rise. People worry, people fear, and we're told as the believers, as the children of God, fear not. Don't fear. Don't allow fear to grip you because God didn't give you that. That's not God making you afraid. John Mason once wrote, fear is like paying interest in advance on something that probably won't ever even happen. Why would you pay interest on a loan you don't even take out? It makes no sense. We're told, don't be afraid. The scripture says, God has not given us the spirit of fear or anxiety or timidity, but of power, love, and a sound mind. The word says fear has torment, but God's perfect agape love, when we talk about chair one in January and say how much God loves you, God loves you. His hand is on you. He is for you. He is not against you. If God be for you, who can be against you? You're going to make it. You're going to be okay. You've been through stuff worse than this before, and you came through. But you forgot. His goodness and his mercy are always following you in an overflow way because he is the great shepherd of the sheep. Fear has torment, the word says. But God's perfect agape love casts out fear. When you can reflect and chew on and dwell on the fact that you are loved, beloved by God personally, not just corporately, but personally and individually, how loved you are, you should be comforted to know that that love forces that fear right out of your being. Yes. Amen. The fear has no room when God's love is being meditated upon. So the world system works through shortage, but the kingdom of God works through abundance. That's how the kingdom works. Supplies increase, prices drop, and then there's more options. People have asked about the word prosperity. The word prosperity. Listen, biblical prosperity always has a purpose, but understand, to me, part of the definition of prosperity is having choices. The less you have in life, and I'm not talking about just finances here, I'm talking about any area of your life, any area where you're in shortage, you have no options. But the more abundance you're experiencing, you have choices. You have choices. One of our precious ladies is going through a job change right now, and she told me a couple weeks ago before I left, that she's taking her time because she's been given a bunch of choices. She has several job offers. Instead of just taking the first one out of desperation, she's fielding the offers and letting God show her what to do. That's prosperity. That's prosperity. That you have a minute to say, God, what do you want? What do you have for me? What's going? What do I need to do? God is a God of abundance. The Bible says in Psalm 91, verse 1 in the Amplified, that he who dwells in the secret place of the Most High, that secret place is simply real intimate relationship. He who dwells in the intimate relationship of the Most High shall remain stable and fixed under the shadow of the Almighty, whose power no foe can withstand. The word Almighty there is the word El Shaddai. It means literally more than enough. If you'll get in the presence, in the secret place, that intimate place with the Most High God, and you'll begin to respond to his voice, and you'll begin to obey what he says and just follow his lead, you will have and be in a place of more than enough. It doesn't mean you're gonna have gold-plated, you know, toilet seats and air-conditioned doghouses and all the excess that people of avarice do. Prosperity is not that. Prosperity I define as having enough to accomplish the purpose for which something is sent. That's what biblical prosperity is. That's why the Bible says, I quoted a few minutes ago, no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Amen. Prosper. A weapon will not prosper. That doesn't mean financially. A weapon doesn't prosper because it doesn't have enough power to fulfill the purpose for which it was sent. Your prosperity and mine is that we have enough and more than enough to accomplish our purpose and have an overflow to help somebody else. Are you getting this? He is a God of more than enough, not just barely enough, not almost enough, but he's a God. He's too much. He's too, God, you're too much. Because of the excesses of the past, some have tried to tarnish the word prosperity as if it's about avarice and greed. But prosperity is a biblical word rooted in the nature and character of God. You're quiet today. Is it because of the time change? I'm loud because I've been through seven. I've reached perfect, complete perfection of time changes. God's perfect number. So you got to wake up, snap out of it. Prosperity and abundance are not just referring to money or finances. That's what we got to get through our thick heads. Prosperity and abundance, when Jesus said that, the stealing, killing, and destruction of the enemy, and Jesus referencing that he came to give life, enjoyable life, in its fullness, in abundance, till it overflows, is not just about money. Get your mind off that. It is about having everything, all sufficiency. Listen, God has and is more than enough in whatever you lack right now. He has and is more than enough love. If you're lacking love, his love is sufficient. Mercy, power, favor, grace, faith, hope, healing, guidance. I told the people on Wednesday night, so one of the miracles that happened for us, it was kind of crazy. When we were traveling from Amsterdam to, we had to go to kind of a smaller city in western Romania called Oradea. And to get there, you had to go through Bucharest, which is the capital. And so we had to actually fly past Oradea and then sit in an airport and then go back, you know, back a little bit, an hour and a half. Well, when we took off from Amsterdam, the weather was horrible, which is normal for Amsterdam, and it was a thick fog and kind of rainy, and we left about an hour late, and I realized that we only had about an hour and a half layover to change planes. So I was hoping it was going to be like, sometimes if you're changing planes in like Atlanta, you just got to get to the next, you know, the next line, you know. Some people say in order to get to heaven, you got to go through Atlanta. But anyway, The reality is you're hoping that you're gonna, if you land in Atlanta and you're changing planes and you land in A terminal, you're hoping that the gate is A terminal. Well, Bucharest had no such thing. It was neither Buka nor restful. So we got off the plane. So first of all, the American concept of when it goes ding, everybody stands up and gets ready, get your stuff to get off the plane. Not in Romania, apparently. In Romania, they decided to stay seated or just block the way off the plane for people who were trying to make connection. So Pastor Chad was with me from Boston, and he was about six rows ahead of me. So I'm just saying to him, we got to move. I said, just go to the plane and get there first, whatever you have to do. So by the time I got off the plane, I walk out of this jetway, and this woman says something to me in Romanian, and I just said, okay, I don't know. I don't know Romanian. She said, oh, are you making a connecting flight? I said, yes, ma'am. She said, where are you going? I said, Oradea. She said, oh, you better hurry. I'm thinking like, I already know that. I said, okay, where do I go? About that time, this guy, I still haven't figured out if it was a human or an angel, but this man walks off the plane, hears the conversation, and says to her, I'll show him where to go, and I'll get him to his plane. And it wasn't a worker. This is just a guy on my plane, the guy on the flight. And he spoke great English, and he goes, follow me. He said, this is a crazy airport. He said, I've got a five-hour layover. He said, this is a crazy airport. He said, follow me, and I'm going to make sure you got your flight. Because the lady said, you got about 20 minutes now. And he goes, this is a crazy airport. There's no transit lounge, meaning you have to go through the passport control to come into a new country, walk out into the airport, and start over. So Chad and I talked about it. It was like going through like an obstacle course. It was like going through an obstacle course, but we had a guide. This guy just stepped out of nowhere, and he goes, follow me. So he waited with us through the passport control line, and then he goes, okay, we're going. And so we went upstairs and downstairs and around stairs and around people, and we get to the security line, and we now got about 6 minutes to make it to the plane. And it's crazy, and we're sweating bullets, and there's not, you know how, everybody know what a Disney line is? You know, where they put the little ropes around and they give you hope. You know what I mean? They invented the line to give you hope. You get through a whole room at, you know, Thunder Mountain Railroad and you go, oh, there's the end. You get there, so there's another whole room. Right? So you get used to that. That's not the lines in Romania. It was a crush of about 150 people all trying to get through four lanes in security. And this guy goes, follow me. Excuse me, these guys have to make their plane. And he acted like he was an important person. And people just stepped aside and let us go through, and we made it to our plane with about 2 minutes to spare. In fact, we were the last people in line when we got there, just loading on a bus and flying on a propeller plane, which is another story that I don't want to talk about now. The point is, when you're lacking something, the God of more than enough, if you'll trust him, is able to send the right person, the right people, the right situation. Not only did we make it, our luggage even made the connection. So I don't know what angel helped our luggage, but our luggage made the 20-minute connection. Thank God, because we'd have been messed up if that was the case. But we made it through. My friends, you've got to trust God. I remember John Maxwell, the great encouraging leadership man of God, said years ago that his grandmother used to pray for him and tell him, when you're in trouble, look for the helpers. Yeah. Never forgot that. Every time you're in trouble, look for the helpers. Call upon the name of Jesus and look for the helpers, because God is going to send somebody to help you. Now, I want to say to you, let's in certain situations take a moment to be the helpers too. Let's take a minute to be the helpers. But look for the helpers when you're going through something. Why? Because our God never lacks anything we need at any given moment. But you have to get your eyes back on him, because otherwise panic can ensue. If you're in panic, you're not in faith. You hear me? If you're in panic in any area where you're in deficit, The Lord of more than enough is able to make up for it with his abundant supply. Deficiency becomes sufficiency. Deficiency, when you have it in yourself, becomes sufficiency. I love 2 Corinthians 12, where Paul writes in verse 9, he said to me, Jesus said to me, my grace is sufficient for you. It's more than enough. My grace is sufficient for you, for my strength is made perfect in your weakness, in weakness. Therefore, most gladly, Paul writes, I will rather boast in my infirmities and weaknesses, that the power of Christ, the anointed one, his anointing, may rest upon me. Therefore, I take pleasure in infirmities, in reproaches, in needs, in persecutions, in distresses, for Christ's sake. For when I am weak, then I am strong. We've all had moments of weakness, moments of lack, haven't we? We've all had moments of just where you're terrified, or you get bad news, or something happens that's just out of the blue, and you go through this. It's like being punched in the gut, and we've all taken those gut punches. But Paul is—he's saying here, he's almost quoting James, where James says, "Look, count it all joy when you go through trials and temptations, knowing this, that God is perfecting your faith. He's maturing it. He's teaching you, and he's reminding you he's God, and you're not." That's a revelation to some people. God is God, you are not. The anointing, the tangible manifested presence and power of the Holy Spirit, is strongest when we're not filled up with ourselves, when we're not self-reliant, self-confident, or self-absorbed, but humbly dependent on the living God. Just humbly dependent. I'm yielded, God. I don't know what to do in this situation, but you're my God, and you are sufficient, and you're my shepherd. As my shepherd, I shall not want anything. I shall not lack anything. Why? Because a shepherd guides. A shepherd leads. He makes me lie down in the best pastures. He leads me beside the peaceful waters when everything's raging. He restores my soul, my mind, my will, my emotions, my imagination, my will, everything. He's working. But we have to trust him. Humbly dependent on God. We are merely the conduits. What's a conduit? A conduit. We are the means or the vessels through which God dispenses his abundant life. Not just for you, but through you to others. We're talking about that a little bit more next week. But a conduit is a channel. It's a pipe. It's a tube. It's a trench. It's a duct. Think about the early Roman irrigation aqueducts. They created these trenches and these lines and pipes hundreds of years ago, before, you know, just when they needed, finding ways to move water out of where it was into fields and farms and crops to irrigate the land. Do you know, that was a seminal moment for farming and food supply in the world when the Romans said, hey, we've got a way that we can channel water from this reservoir and we can get it out to individual farms and individual plants and trees. Jesus said, you shall have rivers of living water out of your belly that will flow, that will overflow. And of this he spoke of the Holy Spirit. Out of your belly will flow rivers of living water. And he's speaking of the Holy Spirit. You and I are conduits for the Holy Spirit to work in us, for us, and through us. But we got to get our eyes back on God in that way. 2 Corinthians 3:4 says this, and we have such trust through Christ toward God, not that we are sufficient of ourselves to think of anything as being from ourselves. It doesn't emanate from me, but our sufficiency, everything we need, is from God, who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. You have a sufficiency. Listen, we're all called to ministry. We've been saying that for eons and eons in this church. We're all called to ministry. Pastors are helping you to find your ministry and lead you into what you're supposed to do, your divine purpose. That doesn't mean you're all supposed to be pastors. Doesn't mean you're all supposed to be prophets and apostles. It means you're supposed to utilize your daily life to serve. Our new t-shirts this year, you'll see them around the room. Richard, stand up and show them your t-shirt, please. Model it. Turn. Give us the muscular. There you go. Turn around. Here to serve. There he goes. Thank you, Richard. I appreciate that. Anyway, here to serve. That came. That was birthed out of prayer that this year our focus is serving other people. Well, as we approach Easter, you are called to be a minister of the new covenant. Well, I don't know what to do. You are sufficient. In fact, if you read those verses, I think the word sufficiency is mentioned 3 or 4 times in 3 verses. You are sufficient. And our sufficiency is of Christ. It's not of us. Look what it says. Who also made us sufficient as ministers of the new covenant, not of the letter of the Spirit, but for the letter kills, the Spirit gives life. You are sufficient. You're going to have everything you need these next few weeks to be a bringer, to bring people to church with you. Now, I have an embarrassing situation I need to share with you. We created some awesome invitation cards for you to give out, and we can't give them to you today. There's a grammatical error. Nancy's pet peeve. She didn't proofread it. PG usually proofreads it. Ryan's been busy doing all kinds of stuff. It says, you're invited, and there's no, you're invited. But no Y-O-U apostrophe R-E. And we just talked a whole month about excellence. Ouch. So I'm letting you know we will have a do-over for next Sunday. And you're having new cards made. You are. Anyway, I know it's just a slip, Ryan. We're not picking on you, Ryan. We love you, Ryan. But anyway. Pastor Chris is supposed to announce at the end, we've got all these cards for you to give out. We'll have more cards next week, and they will be spelled correctly. Otherwise, people will look at it and go, I don't really know what that means. Anyway, but you have all sufficiency, but you got to get your eyes back on God. He is Jehovah Jireh. Literally, the Lord's provision is seen in this place. When Abraham and Isaac go up the mountain, And Isaac is saying, hey, Dad, where's the sacrifice? I see all the stuff for the sacrifice, but where is the sacrifice? And he just kept saying, the Lord will provide, son, the Lord will provide. And the Lord did not provide until Isaac was on the altar and Abraham lifted up a sword. And the Bible says at that moment, there was a scapegoat. That's where we get the word. A scapegoat appears in the branches, got caught in the thorns, like Jesus' crown of thorns. The scapegoat caught in the thorns, and God said, now I know that you're willing to sacrifice your own son, and you'll know what it feels like. And the sacrifice was made. And in that place, the Bible says that Abraham called that place. It was Mount Moriah, but he called the name of that place Jehovah Jireh. The Lord will provide here in this place. He named a place. Do you know what that place became? Throughout history, that place was later on known as Ornan's threshing floor, where David offered the sacrifice and said, I cannot give God which cost me nothing. Today we know it as the Temple Mount, the place where Solomon's temple was built and then rebuilt. That exact piece of land reminds us that God is our provider of what? Of everything we need, and it's always and only right on time. I wish God was early. I pray God is early. I hope for your sake and for your life, you never have to wait till the 11th hour or 12:15. I hope you never have to wait. But I know the nature of God. And sometimes he wants to remind us that only he can get it done. It wasn't because we made the phone calls. It wasn't because we did all the stuff. It was not the sufficiency from us. Some of you out there in sales, I'll make it happen. I'm going to make it happen. Well, good luck with that. Good luck with you making it happen. I want him to make it happen. I want his timing. I want his purpose. I want to be obedient to him. Get your eyes back on God. Final takeaway is this. Don't let your current needs or situations limit the limitless God. Don't fret. They say a man's greatest need emotionally is to be valued, to be affirmed, to be appreciated. They say a woman's greatest need is for security. The problem is when you're going through something, especially as a married couple, you're not necessarily making her feel very secure, and she may not necessarily be making you feel valued if you're both going through something and you have your eyes on that. Step off. It's almost baseball season. Step off the mound. Step off. Regroup. Get your eyes on him. Trust God. Rebuke fear. Don't allow it. Don't allow worry or doubt or anxiety to control you or rule you. Get your eyes back on him. He is the God of more than enough. And he cannot fail to take care of you. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your word today. We trust in you with all of our hearts. We believe the word and the promises. Thank you for the healings that have been started or completed in this room. As we prayed earlier, Father, we give you the glory and the honor. We thank you that pain has no power, that as we leave, we walk by faith, not by sight. You are sufficient to bring wholeness when we feel like half a human. You are the God who provides and strengthens. And I pray for every person today hearing the sound of my voice right now, whether in the room or whether connecting with us in our online campus, I pray that this would be a reminder, a splash of cold water in your face to remind you how loved you are, how blessed you already are, how much God has purpose, and everything you need is in him. Everything you need is already in him. Trust in him. Trust in the Lord. The Bible says, trust in the Lord and do good. Verily, you will be fed. Trust in the Lord and do the next good thing he tells you. Many times, let me just say this, this is in my spirit right now and out of my notes. Many times, when you're feeling the lack, the Lord will prompt you to do something where you feel you're lacking, but you take out of what you have, your widow's mite, out of that lack you feel, and you do something for somebody else in that realm, and all of a sudden, the faucet opens, and God provides you all that you need. You know, I believe you're here for a reason today. I believe this message is for you. I want to pray for you. Maybe you're here today, you don't know Jesus as Lord of life. And if you're still skirting the issue, if you're just still flirting with religion, Jesus isn't religious. If you're flirting with Jesus and in religion, you're missing the whole point. He that dwells in the secret place, the intimate place of knowing Jesus personally, and inviting him in to be the Lord of your life, to be the shepherd of your heart. The Bible says you'll be saved, you'll be changed, you'll be set free. If you're here today, say, Pastor, pray for me. I just want to pray for you before we go. Everybody just say this out loud. Just say this, and if you mean it, I'm telling you, if you mean it for the first time, something significant can shift right now. Just say this out loud. Just say, Jesus, prepare my heart for resurrection day. Help me to know you in a real way. I give you my heart. I give you my life afresh and anew, and ask you to come in and fill me up. In every area where I lack, your word says I already have what I need by promise. Today, I ask you, according to your promise, take care of this situation. Calm my heart and strengthen me for every good work. Let me be a helper to somebody else this week. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. If you meant that today, would you put your hands together for the Lord and trust Him? Praise God. Thank you, Lord. Before we go, we're going to receive our tithes and offerings right now. Ushers, would you get up and give out? If you need an envelope or an I gave card for electronic giving, you want to participate when that basket goes by, that's between you and God. But it's interesting. Did you know that giving offerings to God are His idea, not pastors and preachers? Ooh. Do you remember the night the lights went out in Georgia? It's an old song. Anyway, there we go. We're back on. When Moses went up for 40 days, if you read Exodus 35, he comes down from the mountain, and the first thing he does is receive an offering. And he says, God told me to do it. The first offering, as far as a congregational offering, says in Exodus 35, verse 4, and Moses, he just came down from the mountain, spoke to all the congregation of the children of Israel, saying, this is the thing which the Lord commanded, saying, take from among you an offering to the Lord. Whoever is of a willing heart, let him bring it as an offering to the Lord, gold, silver, bronze. That scripture goes on to say that everybody whose heart was stirred and whose spirit was willing gave freely. And listen to this. It was such a powerful thing that in verse 6 and 7 of Exodus 36, it says, am I having an issue? I feel like I'm still on the airplane. The lights are... Anyway, praise God. We are sufficient. Let there be light. And there was light. Verse 6, Exodus 36, 6. So Moses gave a commandment, and they caused it to be proclaimed. This is at the end of the offering. It says, he caused it to be proclaimed throughout the camp, saying, let neither man nor woman do any more work for the offering of the sanctuary. And the people were restrained from bringing, for the material they had was sufficient. There's the word there, more than enough, for all the work to be done, indeed, too much. They had to restrain people and say, guys, we got to put an end on this offering. Everybody's giving too much. Now, I'm looking forward to the day when we actually have to restrain you. Calm down. Hey, come on, don't attack. We have had moments of spontaneous giving over the 34 years, a few times, where somebody just got stirred and started coming up and setting it on the platform. And miracles happened. We've had that. That's not what I'm after right now. But I'm just telling you, trust God. Believe His word. Claim His promise. And see what God will do if your heart is stirred and your spirit is willing. Okay? Let's pray one more time. Father, thank you for the opportunity to sow and to reap, to gather, to feed, to help others. Thank you for what you're doing through this house in the nations of the earth and right here in our own community because of your abundance through us. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you for your giving. Normally we do a boxes offering this time. We're not going to do the box offering right now, but I want to just focus you, please, on texting to give for the helicopter candy drop. It's not cheap. It's gone up quite a bit since we did it 2019. And so if you want to be part of that or helping with the candy, you can put candy over in the bin or you can sow into it and we'll buy the candy. Anyway, we need you to sign up to serve. We call our Easter Super Bowl day because part of it is it's all hands on deck. If you've been through liftoff, then you should find an assignment of something you can do that day to help somebody else. So there's sign-up sheets available. Pastor Chris, yeah, is that right? Yeah. Okay. Yeah. And I don't know what you're going to do with this, but we're not doing anything with it. Anyway. Very good. Burn the cards. Anyway, we love you. God bless you. Pastor Chris, come and give announcements here.
All right, just to go on what Pastor Richard was saying, just by the way, we bought a big bin out there that we put out there for candy for you to bring in. Well, guess what? You filled it up already, and we're emptying it now to get it ready for some more. So that's awesome. It's just another area of your generosity, so thank you. It's going to be amazing, but let's keep going because we need to fill up a helicopter twice. So it's going to be amazing. All right, liftoff is coming up this next Sunday, so 1 week away. For those of you that are newer to Now Church and wanting to get involved, that's what this is all about, and it's a great time to get involved. We do that at 11 o'clock service, so you can sign up using this QR code right there. It's going to be fantastic. You know, we just got to tell you that every liftoff that we've had this last couple months, we used to do this periodically. Now we're doing this every month, and every month we're having great classes. Just so many people coming to Now Church is amazing. Yeah, so that's so good. I have an announcement for Now Youth. They're in the middle of a 3-week challenge that they're doing with youth. And they say, we know God is doing amazing things. And we're meeting again next Sunday at 6 p.m. for Nuts About Donuts. So they're saying, all middle and high schoolers, bring your donuts and enough to share, and bring your friends. It's going to be a great time. And also, as Pastor Richard had said, we're talking about an all hands on moment for Easter. So if you can put that graphic up there, we have an opportunity. If you are not scheduled already, this is for all of Now crew, if you are not scheduled already to serve somewhere, your leaders or your department leaders haven't contacted you about that day, and you're wondering what to do, make sure you go ahead and use this QR code, sign up, because we want everyone to have an assignment that day so that you have that fulfillment of being involved. We don't want to miss you, okay? It's going to be amazing, and everyone can contribute something, you know, even for your effort and your time for that. It's going to be incredible. All right, go ahead and stand up. We love all of you. Thank you again for your generosity. Be blessed. We'll see you soon.
Thanks for joining us at Now Church. For the latest updates, visit us at nowchurch.com, including live or on-demand video, event registration, online giving, and much more. And don't forget to follow Now Church on our social media platforms, including Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram. And please use the hashtag #NowChurch. Thank you.